Good afternoon. I want to welcome you to our next in a series of webinars presented by CUES. My name is Craig Gleckler, and I'm Marketing Manager for CUES, and I will be your host today. Today's topic will be lateral launch and its applications. In a minute, I will be introducing our speaker, but first I just wanted to review the agenda. The presentation will be approximately 45 minutes. After the first few slides, we will be conducting a brief three-question poll to help us get to know you and better tailor our presentation. At the end of the presentation, we will have about 10 to 15 minutes for some question and answer time. If at any time throughout the presentation you have a question, please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen to type it in. During the Q&A at the end, I will be reading your questions to Al and give him a chance to answer. We will do our best to get to all questions asked. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you today's speaker for our presentation, Mr. Al Milley.
Thank you, Craig. As Craig mentioned, Al Milley, Regional Sales Manager in the Southeast with CUES. Just a little background, worked at CUES for about 5 years now, going on six. Been a product trainer, worked in customer service, worked in sales, worked on some joint projects with engineering. Seen a lot of different things in my time here at CUES. And today we're just going to talk about lateral launchers, what they are, what you need to get started, and how people primarily use them both on the municipal and contractor side. So we'll start out with what is lateral launching. It's much like it sounds, physically launching a camera up a lateral. A few things make up lateral launching: a lateral launcher, the push camera and the push cable primarily, a lateral launch tractor, is a mainline inspection tractor. The tractor itself has a specific secondary function, which is pushing a cable. There is a drive system that pinches or grabs the push cable and pushes or propels the launch camera up the lateral or service or tap, whatever you want to call it. Some launchers come with a fully capable mainline inspection camera. The CUES one does pan, tilt, zoom, focus, lighting good for, you know, pipes up to 36 inch in diameter, whereas some of the competitor systems do not. I have skilled labor up there. All the launcher is essentially a laborer with a push camera that can fit inside the pipe and push a camera head. Rather than a laborer pushing a camera from the surface down via the cleanout, the laborer is pushing the camera up from the connection with the mainline pipe. The second part is why lateral launch. You know, in a word, access. As many of you know, the sewer business is imperfect, and with so many entities having underground infrastructure, meaning gas, electrical, sewer, telecom companies, in addition to changing regulations and, not to be forgotten, masons and landscapers, there are any number of ways the access to a sewer lateral can be inhibited. Buried under a lawn, buried under a fence or wall, paved over by a sidewalk or walkway. So a common theme with lateral launch systems is accessibility and minimally invasive techniques to inspect the sewer system. No one wants to dig up a yard or sidewalk if it's not absolutely needed. And clean out versus not having a clean out is part of that accessibility. So what do you need to get started in lateral launching? Is it just the launcher and the cable, or is there more? You know, more often than not, lateral launching setups are chassis mounted configurations. I believe there are some hybrid portable setups out there, but they're not very common. CUES does box trucks, trailers, and sliding door vans, transit sprinter setups. And that's what's in the picture here is actually a Ford Transit. Regardless of the setup, the unit will have a dual reel configuration. We see that here on the left. We actually have stacked reels here, mainline reel and lateral reel. You know, one cable for the mainline tractor camera power and a second cable for the actual push camera power and propulsion. The second cable, which is on that top silver reel, is essentially the same as a standard push camera cable. Again, all a lateral launcher is a laborer and push camera from inside the pipe. Lateral launch camera heads, like push camera heads, have a sonde inside them for locating. Some have multiple frequencies, which allow for better locating and changing conditions, different soil moisture content, pipe material, overhead or underground utilities, you can swap between frequencies to get a better reading on what you're dealing with. Specifically with CUES, lateral launch systems of old, meaning pre-2009, you know, were rather bulky. They used steel cable, spring cable, you know, as the push camera cable, which did not store on a reel. It had to be actually laid out in the street. The cable could slap the user. It was sharp, push shorter distances, roughly around 80 feet. The tractors themselves were very large, very heavy, and did not operate in 6-inch pipe. But with the growth in demand, the technology has evolved significantly to create a far more operator-friendly system, both in pipe and above ground. The CUES Lamp 2 tractor addressed all of these shortcomings from previous versions. The tractor can operate in 6-inch to 36-inch diameter main lines. The cable, push cable, is plastic jacketed, just like a traditional push camera cable. The push camera cable spools on the top reel. And, you know, again, pipe conditions, you know, kind of define everything, but pipe conditions permitting the system can push up to 180 feet up into a lateral after driving 1,000 feet down the main line. Overall, you know, LAMP2 is a very capable system, hands down, our highest demand product. Common question also is how many laterals per day can be launched? Again, this will vary by application, you know, how it's being used, but average answer I got from on the contractor side, or probably our heaviest users who work in the gas business, is around 20 to 30 would be an average, you know, without any unforeseen pipe conditions, obstructions, blockages, things like that. So somewhere in that range of 20 to 30 laterals if you have good pipe conditions to deal with. So knowing those functions and specifications, how is the system actually used? Lateral launchers are used for three primary purposes. The ones we're going to talk about are lateral ownership and repairs, lateral rehab, and cross-bore compliance. The first is more common with municipal users, whereas the second and the third, lateral rehab and cross-bore compliance, tend to focus mostly on private companies and contractors, although there is crossover, you know, with all of them. All right, so the first and the simplest application we're going to discuss is lateral ownership and repairs. So why does lateral ownership matter? Not a terribly scientific scenario, but all too common for many municipal entities. This comes up quite a bit. Utilities can spend time probing the front yard with a probing rod in search of a clean out. However, this can be a futile task and is only as good as the guesses or maps available. If the utility has lateral launch equipment, the launch camera can be pushed up into the pipe, you know, hopefully to the point of the defect, barring any other circumstance. At this point, the launch camera head in the lateral can be located, thus ascertaining the location of the problem and deciding who owns it. I'll speak to my own region. Municipal customers who have upgraded to lateral launch systems in the Southeast, from having only mainline equipment, often tell me they're not sure how they got by without it in the past, and feel they can pay for it. You know, the system pays for itself in roughly the first 12 to 18 months. So economic and financial costs associated with it, again, it's gonna depend on ownership, and we're gonna talk a little more about that as ownership varies from place to place, but the time spent to go out and locate, and again, you know, then the responsibility of who is actually on the hook for the repair. Is it the homeowner, or is it in fact the municipality's responsibility? We'll talk a little more about that here. So what does the process actually look like? There's really two questions here. One is, where is the problem? Typically a customer will call a utility with a problem, a blockage, and ask them to help locate it. Not sure where it is, the utility will send someone out to locate the defect and launch it. Once they find it, you know, and mark that point, then the second part is who's going to pay for it. And again, based on ownership laws in that area, and they vary, you know, quite a bit from place to place, then that would be decided. But it's essentially a reactive call from a customer to the municipality, and then, you know, obviously a launch and locate from there. again, not a huge, largely scientific process, but again, very common and can be time consuming if you don't have the appropriate equipment to get to it, or there's not clean out access and so on. Just taking a look at Seattle, this was a article from Seattle Times, and this is kind of from a homeowner's perspective, essentially in that particular area, and I'm sure it varies just within Washington as well, but 100% of the sewer lateral responsibility is on the homeowner. So there would be no crossover. The sewer district there has separated themselves from it, so they do not have a responsibility to it. Having said that, you know, they still do, you know, the utility in the area still does spend quite a bit of time actually on the locating process and launching, which does, you know, have an economic time cost to it. So they do, you know, get detracted from actual, you know, mainline inspection work or other ways they could be deploying the equipment to reactive calls. And the speculative cost of a sewer repair in Seattle, again, this was from the homeowner's perspective, but it was about anywhere from $10,000 to $25,000, depending how old the pipes were. The article is suggestive that, you know, much of the infrastructure in Seattle is 60 to 80 years old now, and so it's really showing its age. And with that, there's just this, you know, increased focus on laterals because they are contributing to a lot of, you know, pipe failures and things like that in the area. Moving a little further south, just as a contrasting view, Bay Area Clean Water Agencies. It's an authority made up of basically nine counties and districts. Within that, there are actually 15% of the public water and sewage agencies in the Bay Area own and or maintain the lower portion of the lateral closest to the sewer main. In those cases, the property owner is responsible only for the upper lateral, and the transition, you know, of ownership is basically defined at the cleanout. So again, you know, if there is a call and if there is a defect, there's more room for debate there, essentially over who owns it. So, you know, having the ability to get in there, access it, accurately locate it, is paramount. Obviously, you know, cleanout is the defining point, but is the cleanout always locatable? Maybe not. You know, I'm going to say 95% of the time you have the ability to access from the main. It would be very rare to have an active lateral, you know, not very rare, but less common to have an active lateral be totally blocked at the main to even get in it to inspect. Mobile Area Water, Mobile, Alabama, the ownership is to the property line, which is roughly a 25-foot launch, you know, from the main. And Mobile Area Water estimates that, you know, at least, you know, two or three calls a week, if not more, you know, where they're deploying trucks, you know, even in the, you know, they've had 5 to 10 a week, you know, with major events. So definitely a common thing for them to use and, you know, just to verify, you know, a plumber might locate it at one spot, but they'll go out and verify, you know, if they are being pushed that this might be their problem, just so they don't wind up paying for a repair that's actually not on their side. So with that, you know, if it's 10,000 or so per repair, we just use that as an average, you know, you get, if you're doing multiple of those a year and maybe they're not yours, maybe they are, you know, the addition of lateral launch equipment to a truck, you know, can effectively mitigate some of that risk, some of that cost. Just going a little further south again, you know, laterals are a focal point in a lot of areas, and we'll get into a little more of that in the next section. Brentwood, Missouri, Louisville, Kentucky, again, they own portions of the lateral. They don't own the whole thing. They don't put all of the cost on the homeowner either. They actually have lateral repair programs to incentivize the homeowner to do repairs. So, if, you know, or replace that pipe sooner. Again, if it is, let's say, a $10,000 bill, that can be hard for, you know, something unforeseen for people to repair, so they, you know, probably push back on that or avoid it, you know, in a lot of ways, if possible. Brentwood, Missouri basically had a submittal and approval process for the utility to take over the repair, you know, on certain guidelines. And Louisville MSD actually has a program where they'll offer, I think, up to $5,000 in a loan they'd be paid back, you know, as part of their utility fee or the customer's utility fee to dig up and replace old laterals or old material laterals, vitrified clay and such with plastic pipe, less prone to fail, leak, and so on, just to, as another means to mitigate risk and, you know, disputes. That about does it for discussion of ownership disputes. And just to touch quickly, where does lateral launch equipment fit in with that? It's the ability to quickly access the lateral and verify the location of the defect. That's essentially the role in assessing ownership and repairs. So lateral rehab. Next, we're going to touch on lateral launchers and their role in this process. A quote from Bruce Lee. Hard to find a picture of him with his shirt on, but I did manage. Bruce Lee, be formless and shapeless like water. Some words of wisdom, they actually sort of apply to the lateral rehab world. However you look at it, whether Bruce Lee listened to water or water listened to Bruce Lee, water will keep moving in search of a low pressure area. In the world of pipes, these areas are cracks, joint separations, voids, roots, etc. Water will find a way. So why does lateral rehab matter? Mainline rehab is a very common practice that has been productive for INI reduction and structural rehabilitation over the years. However, it's widely believed that 40 to 70% of inflow and infiltration occurs via laterals, backed up by numerous case studies and contractor accounts from across the country. An example, and this is in the Trenchless Technology magazine as well, but Jefferson County Commission, Birmingham, Alabama, and the greater Birmingham area is in a joint project with Hazen and Sawyer and BLD, currently on a major INI reduction project with a focus on lateral lining. Actually speaking with a contractor working on that project, the reduction in INI via lateral lining, the county has seen not only, you know, improved laterals and INI reduction, but also reduced run times on their pump stations, which led to lower maintenance costs on their pump stations and also lower electricity bills overall. So there are some net effects to it that are not strictly wastewater related or lateral related, so to speak. Treatment capacity is a problem a lot of utilities are facing. With large levels of INI coming into systems, treatment plants are becoming overworked. It's very expensive to expand a treatment plant, so avenues to reduce INI at the source are getting increased focus for their application, and these are rehab products. So lateral rehab is part of a holistic approach to rehabilitating the overall collection system. Mainlines certainly need the work, but adding in laterals and manholes where possible has proven most effectively address INI. And obviously that's a funding permitted scenario, you know, that money may not be available to it, can be done in steps as well, but definitely been some strong data suggesting that laterals contribute to a large portion of the inflow and infiltration in pipes. It sounds like actually, the follow-up presentation from Mark French will be addressing INI in more detail. If anyone wants, you know, more information on that, happy to refer to, you know, engineering firms, you know, contractors who are working specifically in that world, because that's a whole, getting deep into lateral rehab is a world into itself. So what does the process look like? What does the actual lining process look like? And how do launching systems fit into that? There's a little more going on in the lateral rehab world with launchers than there is necessarily in the first step where we're deciding ownership. Roughly five steps to the lateral lining process. And, you know, that might be disputable. Some people may do it in more or less, but I broke it down this way. Essentially, there's an initial evaluation phase. This is a lateral launching step. Basically, the installer or the contractor sees if the laterals on the project can actually be relined. You know, are they accessible? Are they collapsed? Do they need to have their roots removed? cleaning could be involved with this step as well, lateral cleaning. So that's the first step. The next would be the determination and planning phase. What is feasible given the conditions as far as what can be lined and what cannot? So they'll decide lengths of laterals, how far the sleeve is going to go, and that's actually determined by the laws or mandates of the municipality and what they own and what they don't. Pre-installation phase, this is also a lateral launching phase. The installer makes sure nothing has changed since the initial evaluation and liner can still physically get into the laterals. Again, no obstructions. Fourth phase would be the actual installation phase. Launch equipment is not part of the actual installation process in lateral lining. It's actually a train similar to a grout train or skidded cutter train or tractor is used to position the lateral liner prior to deploying and curing that liner. And the fifth and final phase of the lateral rehab process would be the post-installation phase. This is a lateral launching step as well. And essentially, the installer will launch the lateral to confirm the liners are installed properly and prove to the customer that the rehabilitated pipe is in good condition via a recorded video. So with that, three out of the five steps, of lateral lining or lateral rehab process involve lateral launches. So it's certainly an integral piece of equipment in that process. Probably only, definitely recording video in step five. Steps one and three, I'm not so sure everybody records video in those. That might be up to the individual company. But they're definitely verification processes and definitely having the system launched up into it. And just a note on lateral rehab, it would be rare. I asked the question, I did not know myself. It would be rare to have the lateral rehabbed without doing the main line. It's typically in addition to the main line. Only in the rarest of circumstances would you have a standalone lateral liner, from what I'm told. But again, if interested in learning more about lateral lining or companies that are doing it, happy to refer you to some of the people I've spoken with and who can give you a better idea of what's going on there. And I have comprehensive approach and common approach there at the top. Again, a comprehensive approach would be, the holistic approach of main lines, laterals, and manholes, whereas the common approach may just be to do the main line or just the main line and lateral. As you can imagine, the more you're able to seal, the better you're able to address the INI problems. The third and final application we're going to talk about here is cross-bore compliance. And when we are talking about cross-bore compliance, it's gas cross-bore compliance. Cross-bore can be any type of utility passing through one another, for us sewer, but we're going to speak specifically, or I'm going to speak specifically to gas cross-bore compliance. In case you don't know, gas is yellow pipe in the utility world. So is gas cross-bore new? A little background on this. The demand is higher than ever, I would say, but it is not a totally new phenomena. The first known gas cross-bore incident occurred in 1976 in Wisconsin. This is actually a little excerpt from the official write-up in Kenosha with two fatalities and multiple other injuries. In the late 90s and early 2000s, more of these issues started showing up, demanding more strict protocols on installation. So cross-bore is a 30-year-old problem or endeavor. Just awareness and technology available to address it are what's different about today. And I'll say this, catastrophic events with cross-bore typically do not happen at installation. So even though, there's many pipes in the ground, it's a drilling's been going on, for quite a long time. They typically happen when someone ruptures it years after install. So it's not the actual crossing the sewer line that's the problem. It's actually the expansion of the gas and mixing with oxygen and all those things that create the problem, the actual risk. So why does cross-bore work matter? We'll talk a little bit about a few topics here. Is it the law? What is the risk? with it and what are the best approaches for cross-bore inspection. So is it the law? You know, do gas companies, local distribution companies have to inspect laterals by law? There is not federal law surrounding cross-bore. A couple of states have utility laws, but very few. The Pipeline Hazardous Material Safety Administration has regulations that cross over as well. Cross-bore inspection is not a federally or state level regulated practice necessarily to maintain compliance with contracts. Installers typically have to provide video inspection of the laterals, so they are bound by the contract, but it's governed primarily by the gas companies themselves. How far do inspectors need to push? Again, this is variable. Some companies require pushing the camera all the way or to the right of way, you know, where the easements or utilities should be, the utilities right of way. Whereas others are requiring inspectors pushing all the way to the house or structure so as to totally confirm that there is no risk of a crossbore anywhere in that sewer lateral. And to give you an idea, you know, pushing to the right of way, you know, would be roughly from the center line of the road to the right of way, and that would be about a 40 to 60 foot push depending on the area. Whereas pushing to the structure of the house could be anywhere from, you know, I'd say 60 up to, you know, 120. I've even heard of 180 foot pushes in the southeast with the, you know, kind of old plantation style homes set back from the road. So it's certainly variable there as well. But realistically, the push distance depends on the utility ownership of the laterals and the local gas distribution company's policies. Some projects have changed from footage payment plans to completion payment plans, meaning a push all the way to the end point, be it the structure or right of way, rather than just how many feet were inspected for a project to be completed or payment to be, you know, given to the inspector as well, just to incentivize, you know, more detailed inspections and such. And this here is actually a excerpt from a 1999 Kentucky Public Utility Service Commission, I guess you'd call it a landmark statement, where they were actually requiring both the utility and the gas company to work together and, you know, get into marketing and things of that nature, because there really hadn't been any decisions by any commission on what should be done specifically, you know, as this was, you know, cross-bore installation in its infancy. I could provide a link to that if anyone wants to read more on it, but essentially that, you know, that was one of the major statements early on with it. And essentially saying that the utility had to, you know, help mark the sewer lines so to inform the gas company of their location so they could effectively miss them in their drilling process. Liability and risk. Nobody wants a crossbore, you know, that's goes without saying. With that, I've listed some payouts from some cross-bore tragedies over the last 15 years. Unfortunately, many of these include not just property damage, but loss of life, you know, probably sad stuff. For context, there have been at least 20 major cross-bore events where there was a, you know, leak and such into a home that was significant and you know, had an accident in the last 15 years. I've heard energy companies say, as well as inspectors in certain cities, they believe there are, you know, hundreds of crossbores at any one time, especially on legacy projects. The term legacy or latent crossbore I have there. Pretty strong numbers that have been put out, you know, looking at their Crossbore Safety Administration, you know, for a lot of the data, and there was, you know, the number of 0.4 crossbores per mile in a 200 mile radius. In legacy areas, that's a pretty high number. You know, I'm not sure how recent that data is, but anywhere from 0.2 to 0.4 crossbores is estimated in legacy areas. And essentially what legacy areas is pre-2009 is how a number of gas companies define legacy areas. So any drilling done pre-2009, because the wasn't necessarily the awareness of the problem at the time, as well as effective, and easy technology to get out there and address it. And, the awareness has increased drastically, as well as, more effective, more user-friendly systems to be able to access the laterals and also get all the way to the structure or if needed. Many places raise awareness with call before you clear programs for plumbers as well. Again, it's not the cutting of the gas line that causes the problem. The gas is stable in the pipe. However, as the gas leaks out and mixes with oxygen, the gas becomes very unstable and can burn. After a puncture, so meaning after that gas pipe in the sewer line is punctured, and it can be punctured for any number of reasons. A common one is to have a plumber, someone has a blockage, they call up, plumber can't quite see that there is maybe another utility crossing there because there's all sorts of stuff blocking it. Anyway, they break that out, might not realize they hit a gas line. It's not the puncture of the gas line that causes a problem, because it's actually the sewer providing a closed conduit to the house where there are both gas and oxygen available, as well as the ignition sources, so pilot lights, even static electricity and gas appliances, they can all start a fire. So again, it wouldn't happen right away, upon puncturing it. It's kind of an unfortunate enemy that it takes time and it has to mix properly with the air. And then you get, a very, unstable situation. Bubbling in the toilet was a sign that someone said, if you see bubbling in the toilet, it's possible, that could be related to, gas coming up through the toilet and such. Anyway, certainly something to have quite a bit of awareness around, as it is a dangerous thing. I asked the question to one of the engineers I was talking to, are legacy cross bores more dangerous than new construction cross bores? The common opinion is they're all cross bores are created equal. They're equally dangerous. They have equal potential for damage. So the sooner and more detailed inspections happen, the better, because the risk is the same across the board. And, just as an example of a timetable, there was an event in Oklahoma in 2007. But for context, that pipe was actually drilled, that gas line was actually installed in 1992. And then they had the explosion or accident in 2007. So you have quite a bit of time elapsing there before you ever actually see a problem. So kind of a sleeping enemy in that sense. So inspection methods, what are the inspection methods available to address cross bore? There's a few. One, the first being records review. Records review would be kind of like comparing as-built drawings. So it's kind of, it's as effective as the drawings are, essentially. And, again, a lot of places may not have drawings. They may not have up-to-date drawings. So it doesn't provide any visibility into what's going on in the pipe. It's basically saying, well, we drilled over, let's say we drilled on the left side of the house and the sewer's on the right, so we should be good. But it doesn't account for the possibility that someone may have put an addition on their home, added a bathroom, things like that, where there could be conflicting sewer pipes with the gas line or the gas service. Potholing, vacuum excavation, again, this would be, more an invasive, technique. It's, you basically dig a little hole with a hydro excavation unit for a visual inspection. If someone can't launch past a certain point, commonly that's gone to, you do get to see it, you do get a visual confirmation of what's going on there, but you do actually wind up removing soil material and, affecting the person's yard. Lateral push camera inspection, it's still done today. If there's good clean out access, or you can do it with a push camera, but again, it's dependent on being able to get into that lateral pipe. And the final one is lateral launch inspection. And again, having spoken with people working directly for the gas company or a local distribution company in the South, lateral launch inspection was the first choice in that process. So what does the actual cross-bore inspection process look like? What are the steps? Not too different in some ways than the lateral rehab steps, a few less here. The first in the cross-bore inspection process would be the pre-installation survey. Having spoken with contractors, they address this as the most critical portion. This would be drawing and marking the laterals for depth and location. And you know, it was, you know, every 5 to 8 feet was pretty much where the consensus was with the customers I spoke with on how often they mark. They mark depth and footage every 5 to 8 feet they push into the lateral, and also every 10 feet down the main line as well. Green paint, you know, in the front yard is an indication of where the sewer is. You're marking transitions, you know, if there's a 45 degree up angle, a turn, things like that. Those are very important for the driller to know if there's a change in elevation and such. Marking potential hazards, you know, a collapse, a hammer tap, and a gas crew may have to spot dig at that point if the launch system can't get past it. But essentially in this phase, you're giving the driller maps and printed pictures of each house. You might have a software program marking exact locations as well. But this is how people determine how deep to bring the drill bit through so as to miss the laterals. And the crossbore contractor will actually walk the job, or in many cases, walk the job with the boring contractor to explain what's going on at each home and address any questions. The inspector may or may not record a video on the pre-inspection. It's variable, but they are marking in great detail every sewer lateral so as to give the boring contractor the best idea where everything is. The next step is the actual installation. There was no inspection camera work here. This is all drilling crew. The boring crew will install the gas pipe. It's a two-pass process, the pilot hole and then dragging the pipe back through. The goal here, go deep enough to avoid the obstacles, but not too deep so you can't service the pipe. Again, just with the customers that I've been speaking with, the goal was about 36 inches deep, if possible, or to install the gas pipe no deeper than 36 inches deep, if possible, just for serviceability. Once you get beyond 5 feet, you have to start putting shoring boxes in and things like that. And it just gets pretty invasive as far as the digging if you have to access that gas pipe. So from the gas company's standpoint, they would prefer to be as shallow as possible, but also, you know, missing the utilities. And the third step in this would be the post-installation survey, where the crew starts actually out by locating and marking the gas mains and gas services, and may also GPS them, and then launching to confirm no crossbores. Locating is still a part of this process. The locator walks along as the inspector is launching the camera head up there to confirm where he is in relation to that gas pipe. The locator is the eyes of the camera truck operator above ground, as he is the eyes within the pipe. So it's just essentially a risk mitigation step, and there is recorded video submitted to the distribution company for video confirmation of what's going on. The reason for this slide is just, you know, not every street looks like this. Some do. There can be quite a bit going on underground. You know, the gas crossbore would be right here, yellow and green intersecting. This particular home has two sewer laterals in it. This is from the Kansas 811 site. And speaking to one of the local distribution company reps, again, all crossboards are created equal. These ones here, you know, are, you know, let's just say, quote, easier to see, you know, as they're closer to the gas service. The ones that are, and this was her opinion, the ones that are scarier are the ones that are closer to the house. The camera systems, you know, may not be physically able to make it based on the camera diameter or the pipe conditions and such to make it that far, even though the gas line, you know, let's just say, you know, in some cases shouldn't be there, or it should. People might assume that there wasn't a crossbore when there is. And there is also the scenario, which I hadn't thought of, where the gas service crossbores the sewer service. And that can happen very close to the house, you know, or not. But again, it's not something that may be thought of as commonly as the gas main crossing the sewer lateral. It's kind of this shallow intersection. So it's just interesting perspective on it, and, you know, suggestive of the need to have to get all the way to the structure, you know, to have confirmation of, you know, no crossbore risk there. So what does it look like through the eye of a camera? This is a crossbore pretty simple. The drill doesn't feel anything, not with that kind of power, not at that kind of depth. So you might not, definitely need a camera system in there to confirm it. And in speaking with, another user, they said, on average, they think they find and repair about 3 to 5 crossbores per month. So it is, quite common, even with, all of the locating and such going on out there pre and post inspection. There's always a human factor. Is it the driller? Is it the camera operator? Is it the person who was actually painting the depths and such, so that there is, still availability for error. So the post-inspection step is certainly important. If everything is done perfectly in the pre-inspection, and obviously the installation stage is done well, then there shouldn't be a crossbore, but never hurts to look. And even with all that, they're still found. And just finally, on crossbore work here, just some complementary technologies. Obviously locators are an integral part of the process. Without them, you're not going to have your step one, basically, of locating and marking and such. Very common tool used within the crossbore world. Line trace is a feature offered on CUES lateral launch systems, where you can actually hook up a buzz box to the lateral reel and trace out the linear location of where that sewer lateral is in the earth. It's not as accurate really for depth, but if you're trying to get a feel of turns and such for that lateral in the ground, you can actually electrically charge that lateral cable and locate the entire length of the cable. Software, I have here, CUES offers what's called the gas module. It's a way to track pre-inspection, post-inspection, and if needed, excavation inspection on the same lateral, as well as provide forms, reports, and coding systems specifically to gas, with additional capabilities for GIS markers and layers in the GIS world. This is actually a picture taken from a tablet imported into GraniteNet. So GraniteNet didn't necessarily do this, but it's a way to incorporate it in there. And you can see that the user actually drew the sewer lateral here in its relation to the gas meter and such. Another piece of, complementary technology, really it's a core piece of technology, but it's the new CUES micro pan and tilt. This is a new, smaller pan and tilt launch camera designed specifically for, it was really designed in response to the need for customers to have to get all the way to the structure of the building that they're inspecting at. So to be able to make tighter turns, be able to make pipe diameter changes, be able to do pan and tilts, or access into, more tuberculated pipes, older areas, older parts of the country, parts of Florida, parts of the Northeast and stuff have smaller or older utilities, smaller pipes, metal pipes. So again, having a more nimble camera, it definitely assists in the process of being able to thoroughly inspect. This is from a crossbore company in Louisiana. It's not that commonly thought of. Having a lateral, a cutter typically used for cutting out pipeliner, lateral reinstatement and such. You can actually use that same cutter to remove protruding laterals. So you can then launch it. Obviously, if you have a protruding lateral, you're not going to be able to shoot the camera up at it. And if you're getting paid by completion of each lateral, you're going to have a hard time completing it with protruding ones. So to keep the project moving forward, have good visibility on what's actually going on in the pipe, a lateral grinding system can actually greatly assist in that process. Again, initially not something I had even thought of, as being, complementary to the gas world, but users who have done it, have seen a significant, a role for it in the process.
Thank you, Al. Thank you, Al. And I think now it's time for our Q&A session. We have had a few questions come in, so Al, I'll read them to you and give you a chance to answer.
Sure.
So first up, on average, earlier in your presentation, you mentioned that 20 to 30 laterals per day is pretty typical for residential areas. About how far up the lateral would they be going in those situations?
Again, it would depend. I think 21 feet per minute, I think, is what the speed is of a CUES launcher, on its high speed, the actual pushing of the launch cable up in those situations. I did it myself in the greater Nashville area. We did 25, basically from like 8:30 to about 4 p.m. one day. I would say you're probably in the 60 to 70 foot range up each lateral, roughly, you know. And again, a lot of things are going to, you know, if you run into any obstructions, you know, is there, you know, sand in the pipe? If it's new construction, you know, that's going to slow things down. Are there a lot of turns? You know, every time you turn in a lateral, you know, you apply more friction against the cable, so it might bog it down a little bit. We put a lot of torque on our lateral push motor for that reason. So, you don't just have speed, but you also have torque behind pushing that cable up there. And even with that, in some cases, it may not be enough, but, you know, I would say roughly, you know, an average push would be, I don't know, 50 to 70 feet, you know, in those cases, you know, some further. Just speaking to a gas company in Georgia, they require 30 laterals a day, or, you know, they expect, I should say, 30 laterals a day from their cross-bore inspecting contractor. That would be in the, you know, in the Southeast region.
Thank you. All right. Next question. Your diagrams show you traveling downstream and launching backwards. I was trained to not launch backwards as it's harder to do and also harder on the cable. Is that true?
So yes, the diagram did show it driving down, launching backwards. So CUES can launch with or against the flow. It's not right or wrong necessarily with a CUES launcher. Some of the competitor systems are suggested to do it different ways. Definitely easier to go against the flow because geometry is on your side, the angles are easier and they're softer, but having the launch cable actually feathered through the tractor from underneath allows that camera head to actually peak more before it's actually out of the launch tray. So again, not right or wrong. Sometimes you'll only have one access point and have no choice but to do it or but to launch with the flow. I'm sorry, Craig, what was the rest of the question?
Is it true that it was harder to launch backwards and against the flow? This person was trained not to do it that way.
Sure, I would say, you know, it's definitely easier to go against the flow, but I wouldn't say it's right or wrong necessarily. Probably, you know, flex the spring a little more, flex the push rod a little more. So in a perfect world, if you can do it with the flow, or I'm sorry, against the flow every time, you know, it's probably a little softer on the equipment over time, you know, because you don't have those sharp angles and, the, you know, those angles are what, you know, the bending, you know, over time is where you get your, you know, wear points exposed.
Thank you, sir. Next question. Why would you allow cross boring to even happen? A gas line is under pressure and can't be moved up or down in sediment depth without any issues to the gas line itself.
You say that again, Craig?
Sure. Why would you allow cross boring to happen? A gas line is under pressure and can be moved up or down in sediment depth without any issue in the gas line itself.
I almost understand it. I mean, certainly no one's trying to cross bore, you know, the sewer pipe, you know, and as soon as it's located, you know, at least in new construction projects, I think they have to have it assessed, you know, moved up or down, you know, obviously taken out of the sewer pipe, but then the actual pipe raised, the gas pipe raised or lowered within 24 hours. I think it's a very, you know, serious thing they have to address quickly. Again, you know, I don't, you know, certainly no one's trying to do it. It's just kind of a balance of, you know, how deep do we go without going, you know, too deep, you know, to be sensible and serviceable, you know, meaning how deep do we go with the gas line? You know, do we go just 10 feet deep every time, or, you know, do we go, you know, try to make it a little closer and more accessible so we can service it? I think that's, you know, kind of the balance that the distribution company is trying to play or trying to weigh, you know, when they do an install. And it's true, you know, it can be raised or lowered, but, and they do. But again, it's just, you know, there's also a degree of human error in there, I think. You know, if the first step pre-inspection and marking is done perfectly, the contractor or the inspector walks the job with the boring contractor and, you know, the installation's done perfectly, then, you know, you would hope that cross-bore wouldn't happen at all. But, you know, things have happened, you know, and it is rather common. So they, you know, they do have, you know, the launch systems in there to address it.
Thank you, Al. All right, just a few more questions here. Will there be any video showcasing actual laterals being launched?
I don't have any. I mean,
CUES might ask a better question for me.
Yeah, but maybe it's something we can, you know, put on the website at some point or on the YouTube page. You know, we have any number of customers out there launching laterals. So it's, you know, certainly I would say our fastest growing demand product years ago, it used to be, you know, probably 60-40 or 70-30, you know, with the higher number being mainline trucks that CUES made and the lower number being lateral. And right now it's probably 50-50 to even skewed, you know, 60-40 towards lateral launch trucks over mainline trucks. So it's definitely had a major swing in the last 5 to 8 years.
And now I can say that on our CUES YouTube channel, if you guys can go to there, there are a few videos we have of showing lateral launch and what it's like. I think we are using our LAMP 2 system with the mini pan insult, but you can see, we have some cutouts of the pipe there, that kind of stuff that you can't see. Our next question, I think you already answered this question, but is it better to go against or with the flow of the sewer when trying to launch a lateral?
Yeah, I mean, again, I would say, you know, in a perfect world, going against the flow will be easier. It's going to be, you know, typically easier access just based on the angle of the laterals. But with the CUES system, you know, one of the hallmarks of the LAMP 2 is you can go with or against the flow because of that way the camera is mounted or the cable is mounted underneath the body of the tractor.
Thank you, sir. Next question. Has the lateral inspection technology advanced to provide launching from main lines of 36 inches and larger for quality inspections?
36 inches and larger is an interesting question. I shouldn't say it, but, you know, officially CUES doesn't have a configuration for that size. We have some pretty big wheels for that tractor, but we do have customers who do use the system in up to 60 inch diameter is the biggest I've heard of. And essentially it's modifying what we use for 36 to fit, if you can believe that, to fit in a 60 inch main. Not an official configuration, not a, you know, a very common request, but I will say we do have people who do homemade modifications to some of the setup to launch in those very large diameters.
Okay. Thank you, Al. Next question. This was person asked, what is legacy? I think you'd mentioned that earlier, legacy versus latent crossbore.
Yeah, legacy would just be, it's kind of a general term, but without applying a year to it, I would say it's gas lines that were installed before 2009 is how one of the gas companies was defining it. So I just take that as a general term. Lines drilled before 2009. So anywhere from, you know, in the 90s, early 2000s up to 2009. And 2009 is really, it seemed like when there became much more oversight and awareness of what was going on. And on those legacy ones, there wasn't, you know, it's one thing I didn't touch on, but, you know, legacy programs, you know, gas companies, you know, generate revenue from, you know, obviously new installations, new customers, things like that, you know, and that's part of the cost. But legacy programs, there's not necessarily revenue coming in from legacy inspection, from inspecting the legacy work. So it's a cost, but it's a cost, you know, the inspection cost is weighed against the cost of an accident.
Thank you, Al. A few more questions. Is it possible to perform a lateral launch with a connection that is not a factory tap, but a tap break-in?
I would say yes, as long as the mouth of the lateral is open. You know, you can probably get the launch camera in it. Again, the sewer world's very imperfect, so all sorts of things are seen out there. So I would say, as long as it's not obstructing the tractor from getting down the main line, you could probably do it.
Okay. Thank you. Next question. Would you recommend launching side serves that you locate? Oh, hold on, let me read this again, sorry. Would you recommend while launching side serves that you locate it with and record it GPS for further locates?
I sort of understand the question. You could definitely GPS. So people do GPS the laterals, so for a number of reasons. One would be, to make a layer on a map, someone's existing, arc map or, GIS system, they could actually draw where that sewer lateral goes, whether it's left, right, straight, and so on. I would say it depends on what the end user, really wants. I that actually came up speaking with one of the gas customers, and the gas company didn't feel like it needed to have GPS sewer laterals, but it wanted to have GPS, GPS in some cases on the gas, I believe. Could it help the utility out? Yeah, I would say it could probably, GPSing where that lateral is could probably help the utility for the future. If there's some other utility going in, or, just a question of, trying to find the lateral, the clean out and so on, if you know the GPS coordinates to it, you're going to be a lot more effective. So, everything has a cost. So it's just a question of, if it's a utility doing it, it's definitely going to give you some detail, and it may help you, create some, very accurate maps and drawings and things like that, which, probably in most cases haven't been kept up over time exactly. So it could definitely help to create a good file to refer to. But if it's a gas company or gas work, the gas company may not be interested in the sewer necessarily in that case. So it'd be more of a case by case thing, I think, of who's actually wants to use the data.
Okay, next question. How do you prevent a transporter from tipping over in 24-inch pipe?
Yeah, I'm assuming it's basically sliding. I'm assuming it's when it's launching that the problem's happening. I'd have to see it, to really see what's going on necessarily, see the setup and see how it's rolling, to really, help assess what's going on. But, if whoever asked the question wants to follow up me on, I'm happy to, to lend it any help, afterwards, just to get a better idea how whatever's happening is happening.
Tim Wilson did respond real quick, saying keep tension on the line and keep it straight in the line.
Wonderful.
Let me see if we have just a few more questions here. Is the lateral cutter grinder able to be used at the same time as the initial inspection, or does that need to be done separately?
Yeah, it would be separate. Not the same tractor. It's a entirely different tractor system. You run it off the same gold cable on the truck. I wish I had a picture in here actually, but you can have a combination lateral launch cutter truck actually. We do make those. So, one unit could go out there and do all of that. And if they run into a protruding lateral, then they can pull out the lateral launch system and then deploy the cutter system. It would be a two-step process, for better or worse, but you can effectively address how deep that lateral is pushing in.
Okay. And I think we'll have to go to our final question here, as we're a little over time here. Just final question is, do you have written documentation dealing how the CUES equipment is designed to launch into lateral and then the associated Ys? For example, where you put the guide rod, which way you rotate it, et cetera.
I don't think that a manual might have that. If you're asking about how to position the guide rod basically to best navigate through Ys and Ts and stuff, I don't know if we have documentation on that. Could definitely have, whoever asked, wanted to speak with a trainer. A trainer could certainly, I would say, could address that. I would say probably also, not the answer anyone wants to hear, but it probably depends on each situation. So there might be a little Kentucky windage to it, and which way you want to position the camera at each time. But there are probably some fundamentals to it as well. I haven't, you know, used guide rods as much myself and, you know, navigated it. You know, I, you know, tend to do it without it and just raw pushes. But, you know, again, I don't work every day, so I don't see everything that goes on. You know, I typically do product demonstrations. So, you know, people who see a lot more would have a better insight than I do on that. But I would say a trainer could probably best address that question, you know, just from, you know, more time in the field, seeing customers do it and so on.
Thank you, Al. I think that'll about wrap up our webinar. I'm sorry if we didn't get to all your questions. I am making note of all of them, and we'll be sending them all on to Al. We do want to thank you all for attending today and hope that you found some value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding lateral launch, please feel free to reach out directly to Al. His contact information is on the screen. Or you can always visit the CUES website for more information. Once again, thank you all for attending.